Hello and welcome to this presentation announcing Flow3D, Flow3D Cast, and Flow3D Hydro versions 2022 R1, December 8th. Welcome everyone. So first, company LinkedIn, thank you. We have reached 10,000 followers on our LinkedIn page. That's wonderful. And we have a nice, fun animation from our friend Eric Lamont in Flow Science Australia. Thank you. That's really great. We are pleased that you can stay connected with us through our LinkedIn page. Thank you for that, and welcome everyone to today's presentation. Okay, so another thank you. Thank you to all of the Solver and GUI user interface developers, the product development engineers, the Q&A team, marketing, support and application, and everyone on the Flow Science team, and today's presenter, that's me, John Wendelboe. I'm glad to be here. Really, we do enjoy connecting with everyone, and LinkedIn's kind of a nice place to do that, and I encourage you to, if you haven't already visited the Flow3D LinkedIn page, please do. So today's agenda, first of all, where's my new release? So marketing has sent out emails, of course, to everyone, but you may still not be quite sure, so we'll talk about that, how to download the latest version of either Flow3D, Flow3D Hydro, or Flow3D Cast, and we'll also explain a little bit what's happening with the new versioning and a new synchronized release schedule that we have adopted this time around, and for future releases as well. And then I'll dig into developments. We'll talk about templates, a new cut cell method, pump objects, very important development called two-dimensional material properties tables, and then continue talking about developments with the moving droplet sources, some extensions to the active simulation control features that we have, a new oxygen dissolution model, a volume of fluid to particle developments, and then we'll end with some user interface improvements and a few additional solver features. So let's get started. Again, welcome everyone. Okay, so where's my new release? Well, it's on the user site. So I encourage you to go to users.flow3d.com, and there is a section there that says products and installation. And these products have all of our releases, Flow3D, AM and Weld, Cast, Hydro, Post, and Flow3D X. So download your installation, and you can do this in either Windows, Linux, or if you're using the HPC, high performance computing version of any of our Flow3D products, you can download it from there as well. You probably will also need a new license, and you can request a license file from licenses at flow3d.com. So download the installation, get yourself a new license to be able to run the latest versions of Flow3D products, and then while you're there, you might as well make sure that you also have the latest Flow3D post, which is also downloadable from the user site. The latest version is, in fact, was released on July 1st, last summer. So if you don't have the latest, please do download the latest. This is what allows you to do all these wonderful renderings. This is also from Flow Science Australasia. Photorealistic rendering, animations, motion, those sorts of things. It's really a great post processor that we have for you. Okay. So talking about the user site, might as well also let you know, in case you don't, that yes, we have the products and installation, but we also have a lot of other resources available there. So there's training materials, support resources, cloud computing, etc., services. But really, the kind of maybe the most useful ones besides the installation that we've kind of already talked about is really with the training and resources. So training is product specific. There's training for Flow3D, AM and Well products, Cast, Hydro, Post. The training can be video tutorials. It can be also simulation examples. It can be focused on specific problems or model setups, A to Z's kind of things, or it can be focused on the actual different physics that we have in Flow3D. So a lot of materials there in the training, and for instance, we've added a couple of examples there for the release of Flow3D 2022 R1. We've added a bottle filling model setup, a droplet generation model setup, and an inductor structure, which is a two fluid problem, has also been added as a video tutorial. And we're always adding new training materials constantly, so this is a page that you can visit regularly. We also have under the resources section different articles, also different sample simulations. Depending on what you're interested in, you can kind of filter out. Maybe you'd like to see simulations that are relevant to microfluidics, for instance. So you can search all of these simulations, and sometimes it can be a very useful starting point if you're starting a new project. Okay, so just wanted to mention the user site. It's really your friend, users.flow3d.com. Anything from installation, training, general information, support, and much more. And you do need to register to use the site. So just visit the website and request a password and an account if you don't already have one, and then you'll be able to do all these nice things. So a couple of other comments here while we are on the topic. First of all, you'll see that the versioning of Flow3D products has changed. We used to have V12 or V11.2 before that for Flow3D, so those are now kind of out of date, and the new system we have is 2022 R1, meaning release number one of 2022. There'll be a 2022 R2 next summer, 2023 R1, etc., as we make progress. And the same thing goes for Cast. We no longer have what we used to have, V51, 50, etc. That's gone. We now have the same 2022 R1, and the same goes for Hydro. So 2022 R1, that's where we are with that. And then something else to notice is that we also have a synchronous release date for all of these products. So in this case, a couple of weeks ago. And what that also means is that we are releasing the different versions of the software at the same time. So Windows, Linux, and HPC. In the old days, we used to have a delay between the HPC version and the workstation release. Also, Flow3D would not be released at the same time as Cast, would not be released at the same time as Hydro. And I'll explain in just a moment why we've changed things a little bit. Before we do that, I also wanted to highlight a What's New release notes, which are available in the same window on the website with all these products. And the What's New is also kind of a interesting read. It's application or product specific. So you would have one for Flow3D, one for Cast, Hydro, etc. And there's What's New, which is kind of a general paragraph, but then it's followed by some detail of all the different kind of new features that have been included in either the Hydro release or the Flow3D release or the Cast release, etc., etc. For today, I'm going to talk about everything kind of together. And if you want to see the detail of what's in which product, you can easily see that on the user site. Okay. biannual synchronized release schedule. So the new versioning we have, 2022 R1, for instance, reflects a new synchronized release schedule. And biannual means occurring twice a year. I had to check that for myself. It doesn't mean every 2 years, it's twice a year. Why are we doing this? Simple reason. We want to make developments available to the user as soon as they are ready and across all platforms. That's the driving motivation for these developments. So we have two releases per year. One now, we're in December, it's basically the early 2022 release. There'll be one in the summer of 2022, which will be R2. And then we repeat the cycle in 2023 and so on. So the what this means essentially is that we are moving towards a feature-driven release schedule, which means as soon as something is ready, we make it available across all products where relevant. So, you know, a Hydro development may not be, of course, released in Cast or Flow3D. Cast development may not be relevant to Hydro and so on. The idea, though, is that we are always trying to get developments into your hands as soon as we can, and this is a good way of doing this. So when you open your solver, your Flow3D, your splash screen, your user interface, what you'll see there is the solver version. 2022 is the year, the release number followed by the build, and then the product could be either Hydro, Cast or Flow3D, and nothing's going to change in terms of graphics, except that on your desktop you will see Flow3D 2022 R1 instead of, for instance, the old V12.1 or V12.2 and so on. Okay, so I wanted to kind of take a moment to explain what had happened with that, and where to get good information, where to get your downloads, how to get your license and so on. So let's talk now about different developments, and we'll start with templates. And templates are kind of a powerful and very interesting way of doing things. We kind of developed that initially with Flow3D Cast, and then we introduced that into Flow3D Hydro, and it's a really a nice way of working. And so we've also now introduced some templates in Flow3D. And what's nice about templates is that you can use templates to control defaults for different products and applications. It could be solver defaults, application defaults, process or sub-process defaults, and you can kind of fine-tune things to the type of work that you're doing. And so whether you call it a template, or kind of under the template might be an application, a process or a sub-process and so on, all of that is the same idea of being able to fine-tune some of the default parameters that you use, different stages of your modeling for different products. So all this basically simplifies your life as a modeler, and then you can jumpstart your modeling basically at the model setup stage, and then very quickly move on to run your simulations. So we already have those in Hydro and Cast, and so we've added those in Flow3D, and you know, these templates preload important parameters. Because Flow3D is a general solver, not particularly tied to any given application, what we've focused on for templates is to kind of preload the basics. So it could be a free surface, one fluid, true VOF, incompressible fluid. It could also be a confined flow with incompressible fluid. It could be a two fluid compressible fluid, and so on. So these are different possibilities, things that you might model with Flow3D. And so when you open Flow3D, when you open a new simulations, you will just decide what basic modeling premise you are interested. Once you've done that, let's say, for example, a two fluid compressible flow, what this will do, it will first preload the right settings in terms of interface tracking, number of fluids, two flow mode compressible, and it will also activate the physics that are necessary in order to run these types of simulations. So this will mean that you need density evaluation turned on, and heat transfer, turbulence and so on. So those are some choices that are made for you to kind of accelerate your modeling journey. Next, an important development maybe a very important development, something called the new detailed cult cell method. So you're all familiar with the standard favor method, which enables users to efficiently simulate flow through underground geometry without needing unstructured body fitted grids. That's kind of the beauty of Flow 3D. What we've done here is we've added a new type of favor representation, something called a detailed cut cell representation. What this does, and it greatly improves the calculation of wall shear stresses. So the detailed cut cell representation is kind of an alternative favor method. It's a more detailed favor method. So what you're doing is getting a more accurate representation of the surface and the flow around the surface, and this really helps with shear stress calculations. So you can still use favor if you'd like. The user can choose either the standard favor approximation or the new detailed cut cell method. The detailed cut cell method results in significant improvements in the calculation of drag forces on solid surfaces, as well as pressure drops along surfaces and in channels. So it's an important improvement, and I'm going to just show you a few examples here of some standard applications. We'll start with kind of not the simplest, but one of the kind of simpler problems, just a laminar flow past a cylinder with a low Reynolds number. So we have some experimental data, and what you can see is here is the mesh convergence, as it were. So the blue one is the coarsest. We have 10 cells across the diameter, and we are still getting actually pretty good results in terms of pressure distribution around the cylinder, and not so great results in terms of friction coefficients along the perimeter of the cylinder. If we adjust the meshing a little bit, to 20 and then 40 cells across the diameter, we basically end up exactly mimicking the results of experiments, but also a body fitted solution. So that's extremely encouraging in the laminar case. And then we can look at a turbulent case, a flow around an airfoil, and there's much more detail actually on all of this on the Flow 3D website under modeling capabilities, detailed cut cell representation. So I encourage you to go and read there. But what we're seeing here, if you look at body fitted or experimental data and we plot our results using the cut cell method, pressure coefficient is excellent. And here we have also plotted the upper surface skin friction, also very, very good. So this is a Reynolds number of 10 to the 6. So very encouraging. A very important, especially for mechanical engineers, for civil engineers, pipe flow, obviously. So smooth or rough, laminar, turbulent, we want to, you know, this is a good test to see if you're calculating your shear stresses accurately. And so we have set up this model, and we ran this in a laminar case here on the left, and also in a turbulent case with different levels of surface roughness. And so on one aspect is, you know, how are we estimating the friction factor for all these different cases, and you can see that basically we have an excellent agreement almost everywhere, except maybe for the very coarsest case for surface roughness, and that's within 10% or so, and then for different, for a whole range of Reynolds numbers. So this tells you something about the robustness of the solution. This plot on the right here also tells you how well we do with the various angles and how the different planes cut across what remains an orthogonal Cartesian mesh. So the uniformity of the friction factor here across the radius of the pipe is also really encouraging. It's also very, very close to the actual solution. So really, really encouraging results here. Same thing with a boundary layer development on an inclined flat plate. And you might think, oh, well, this doesn't look so great. Huh? This is actually a Reynolds number based on the distance along the plate for a let's say global or length driven around the number of 10 to the 7, so turbulent flow. And if you think about it, this length here is actually only corresponds to the first percentage or so of the length of that plate. So this portion of the plot you really don't need to worry about at all. What we have here is in fact a really good agreement along the rest of the plate for the shear stress along that friction coefficient along that plate. So that's also really, really good news. Same there. And then a final test there that we had, vortex shedding in the wake of a beveled plate, and we were also able to get some really, really good results across a whole range of angles of attack. So that's the Struhal number, which is the kind of frequency associated with the vortex shedding. So really promising results using this method. So I definitely encourage you to use this method. It's just a great way of doing things, keeping an orthogonal mesh. And you still have a choice, of course. You can do detailed versus standard. And the way you activate this method is in the numerics widget. And the standard represents the regular favor method that we have used for decades. And then the detailed option is the new version that's offers improved representation of shear stresses acting on walls. So you probably remember that we introduced an immersed boundary method a couple of years ago. These are slightly different things, and currently they're not, you know, compatible. Not for very long, but currently they are not compatible. You use one or the other. So you can use immersed boundary method, or you can use detailed cut cell. So when to use which? Well, activate detailed cut cell in the numerics widget when the momentum, that's where you activate this, in the momentum equation in the numerics. That's where you would activate this. However, you have a choice. And which one should you use? Should you use immersed boundary or cut cell? So what you would do is use IBM for advection-dominated problems, but you would use detailed cut cells where viscous boundary layers effects are important. And at the moment, you would make a choice. So this is a current limitation, but the good news is we have two very good methods. One is IBM, one is a detailed cut cell representation. They're not currently compatible, but that's coming. And then the other thing to note is that the detailed cut cell representation is not currently deployed on moving objects. So until both methods are merged, until we have cut cell for moving objects, and both of those are in the pipeline, in the development pipeline, it is recommended to use detailed cut cells when viscous boundary layers effects are important, and IBM in advection dominated situations. So I hope you use this and look at things for your own problems and send us your feedback. That would be terrific. But we are very excited about this new development. Another development, which is going to simplify our lives substantially in certain cases, is the axial pump object. So an axial pump object is offers basically a simple linear approximation of a pump's performance curve. So when you have a pump performance curve, you might have different power settings, different flow rate versus head settings. And what we do now is that we create a linear approximation of this curve, which you can use to approximate the dynamic behavior of the pump, or you can also use this model in a fixed operation mode where you're saying, well, the flow rate, for instance, is 150 liters per second. That's the black line. So you can either fix the flow rate and say, well, this pump is going to push a fixed flow rate, or you can say, well, we have a flow rate that's going to depend on the local conditions. You can do both. Okay, so what does this look like? You will have an actual pump object, which is a geometric component, could be an STL, could be a primitive. You'll define the pump flow orientation. You will, if you want to get the actual rate of work transferred to the fluid you will specify the flow area and then what pump operation mode you want to be using. So it could be fixed flow rate or performance curve. Okay, you will then run this. What you can see here is that we have, for instance, a pump object here. And so we're going to run this. And what you'll see now is it's pushing water basically through the pump. And the bottom picture shows you what's happening in terms of the pressure field. So what you can see there is that the pump is basically exerting pressure, enough pressure to change the momentum of the fluid in either a fixed mode or a dynamic mode. Okay. So what's interesting there is comparing both. So on the left here, we have a fixed flow rate. And on the right, what you can see is that as the, by right, I mean the right-hand conduit here, as there's more and more pressure working against the pump, the flow rate is actually going down and down and down until it reaches a steady state. So these are two different operations. This is the fixed flow rate. This is the pink pump pushing water at a fixed flow rate. That's one way of using this model. Well, then the other one is to have a more dynamic way of doing it, in which case initially when you have no head you have pretty much the optimal flow rate, 6, but as head develops over and pushes back against the pump, this flow rate is going to decrease, decrease, decrease until we reach steady state. So that's how that works, the fixed flow rate mode and the performance curve mode. And so this is completely tied to, you know, the dynamics if you're using the dynamic mode. So in this case, what I wanted to show you here is we have a pump. Same thing, the flow rate goes down as you increase the amount of head pushing back against the pump. So that's completely normal. Pressure here is non-vented. So this pressure at the moment is still vented. But what's going to happen is that we are in fact going to create a sub-atmospheric pressure zone here by because of air entrainment. And then what's, what I'm trying to show you here is that when you create some kind of dynamic condition here, in this case with sub-atmospheric pressure, this is in fact going to work with the pump model that we have, so that you have a very accurate representation of what's actually happening in the flow. So that's kind of an interesting way of doing things with respect to pumps. So that's that. And then how do you define these things? Well, you go into the, they are under the components kind of umbrella. You're going to put those under the fan impeller pump model. And then you will be able to define your component that way. And then you're going to, instead of using a fan impeller component, what you're going to do is you're going to say, I want an axial pump component. And then you will be able to select your different options depending on how you want to define your pump. Okay. All right. There's an alternative, in fact, to this model, which is very similar, but a little bit different. It's called a momentum source. It does the same thing as a pump, but it doesn't rely on a components like an STL geometry or a primitive geometry. It's just, you know, it could be a square, flat square or flat circle, just like we have mass sources at the moment. What we have now are momentum sources. So they don't inject any mass. They only inject momentum into the flow. And everything else is the same as with pumps. And it's pretty much the same thing. So you can also basically inject momentum into the flow using this as an alternative to a geometric objects. Okay. So those are for the first three developments that I wanted to talk about today. And the next one is a two-dimensional materials properties table. So what is this? Quite often, when we are talking about complex fluids, could be glassy fluids, viscoelastic fluids, polymers, all sorts of things, there's a dependency of certain fluid properties. Could be densities, surface tension coefficients, viscosity. Those dependencies could be on more than one thing. So, you know, we know that, for instance, viscosity might be a function of strain rate, but it might also be a function of strain rate and temperature, or viscosity might be a function of strain rate and density, or strain rate and a scalar concentration. Density itself could be a function of temperature and maybe a scalar concentration. Surface tension could be a function of two variables, temperature and something else. So we didn't really have a way to do this before, not a simple way to do this in Flow3D. So we've introduced two-dimensional tables. So now when you have material properties and you'll have some kind of table such as this one, we are going to be able to bring that in into the fluid properties. So the objectives of this development were to allow for 2D tables, viscosity and density, and then we also added surface tension, allow for different independent variables, and we also wanted to make this a general feature for fluid properties. So we will be able to easily add more complexity as needed in the future. So in your fluids, you would basically go, if you wanted to define density as a function of two variables, just go to your regular density tabular function. If you were doing viscosity also in the fluid properties, you would go under tabular in the viscosity section. Or if you're doing surface tension, you would go to the fluids, not fluid one, but the interface. If you're not familiar with surface tension, it gets defined at the interface between fluid one and fluid two, or between fluid one and a solid. So in this case, you would also choose the tabular function there. And what this is going to look like when you open these 2D tables is that you're going to be able to define viscosity as a function, in this case, of strain rate and density. So you'll, for a given density, let's say of 1,000, you'll be able to define strain rate, viscosity. And then on the next table over, you can see that it's a density of 1320. These are the different density, and these are the different curves that are associated to each different density. And then there's a bilinear interpolation to figure out the actual value of viscosity to use. Okay, so it could be something like this. In this case, we have strain rate, temperature, these types of tables, this case viscosity, shear rates, and temperature. All of these types of dependencies can be modeled now using this new feature. So to give you an example here, we have viscosity as a function of the density of fluid and the strain rate magnitude. So in the top left, we have the density. So some portions are clear, in this case, clear water. And then we have some denser fluid here, 1400, up here and also down here. So this is layered with two fluid regions. This is a 2D cut. This is the strain rate magnitude, which at time zero is just zero because nothing's moving. And this is the dynamic viscosity at time zero, based at the moment just on the values of density. But as this becomes a dynamic system, what you're going to see is that as the hydraulics move the fluid around and the strain rate is non-zero, this is then going to affect the viscosity in the flow. Okay, so we've added quite a bit of realism to the fluid properties for quite complex situations. Okay, the next one is moving droplet sources. So what you can see here is exactly that, a droplet being ejected from a source, and then it's being ejected into porous media. That's why it's kind of sinking in to the substrate. And what we have the ability to do now is to basically give a motion to these droplet sources. You'll basically define your droplet source. There'll be some definitions, there'll be some options, you know, about the contents of the droplet itself. And then it can be a droplet, or it can also be a bubble, and then you'll have different types of options depending on what you are doing. A droplet is liquid, a bubble is gaseous, etc. Okay, moving on, the next development here I wanted to talk about today is an extension of the active simulation control features. So ASC, as we call it, has always included controls based on probes. But what was missing was general history data, flux surfaces, and sampling volume. So now the controls are based on pretty much everything that's available to you in terms of measuring things in Flow3D, Hydro, or CAST. So the measurement tools that we had are the general history data. For instance, things like the maximum temperature in the fluid, or the volume, the kinetic energy in a fluid, etc. So that data is available, and then we have probes, flux surfaces, and sampling volume. So those are things that we can measure with, and then now those are tied to actions, and so events, what we call. So we can, for just an example here, but you can terminate a simulation when the maximum melt temperature falls below a critical value. This would be, the control would be a general history data. You could increase the output frequency during a fast fill stage, as determined by the average velocity on flux planes, as opposed to just a probe, so it's less noisy. That's using a flux surface. You can control the fill level in pouring based on a sampling volume, instead of seeing if a probe has a volume fraction, fluid fraction of one or something. So yeah, there's it's more robust in many cases, and it's just more adaptable to different situations. So for instance, in a metal casting problem, what you would have is a sampling volume, which would be the actual investment, and you would use that to control certain behaviors. So when you turn your metal source on and off, termination, control of the pour, those sorts of things, it's more robust than using just probes. Okay, so conditions that trigger, has a little video here that shows you what this looks like. You have a history probe, could have which specific history probe you're using, a sampling volume, which specific sampling volume you're using, what's the probing variable that you want to use in each case, and then after that you will select some condition and which will trigger some events. Might be X velocity, might be any number of things. So this is a very simple extension, but a very useful extension of what we have with probes for the active simulation control. Okay, and this is extended to all object types, global conditions, valves, vents, mass momentum sources, and so on. Okay, next is the oxygen dissolution model. So this is an actual new physics model, it has a new picture, I suppose, a new kind of item in the physics. It's called oxygen dissolution, and when you open this, just like with every other physics model that we have, you're going to activate the model, and then you'll have some properties that you're going to need to input. So for the case of some kind of air mixture, for instance, we'll have oxygen, nitrogen, then we have Henry's law constants, we have the mass transfer in bubbles, which could be a concentrate. We also have a couple of extra models for clean fluid or clean bubbles, or what we call dirty contaminated bubbles, and so on. So you'll basically input your model parameters, and then just like with scalars or scour or any number of other kind of scalar type models, reaction kinetics and so on, you will be able to define some concentrations at initial conditions. You might also have some sources where you have to define the condition of the flow as it enters the domain, and you will have something with boundary conditions where you would also be able to prescribe the dissolved concentration or the gaseous volume fraction. Yeah, so what this will look like in an actual model, this is a diffuser example, and what this is going to give you is a spatial map of the evolution of dissolved oxygen based on local hydraulics, local flow conditions, local air concentration conditions, local dissolved oxygen concentration conditions, if we've reached saturation and those sorts of things. Okay, so that's an interesting, a very interesting model, which we look forward to using more. Then maybe the last development that I want to talk about today is the VOF to particle. So VOF to particle, as you know, when you're using VOF, there's one kind of difficulty is when you have very small regions of fluid. They no longer get resolved by your mesh, and then you have some kind of difficulty there that you can either kind of poorly resolve these small blobs of fluid as they travel through a single mesh cell, or you can get rid of them altogether, which is not great for mass conservation. But we don't really have a good method to capture the behavior of very, very small droplets of fluid. VOF is better suited for an interface, complex interface, but still a resolved interface. So as the regions of fluid becomes too small to resolve with the computational mesh, these small fluids, fluid regions are converted into Lagrangian particles. So we are taking this small blob of fluid and say, well, let's stop trying to resolve this with VOF, and let's instead turn this into a liquid particle. Then these particles can travel through space. Eventually, they could reintegrate the bulk of the fluid. That's not a problem. And then what we kind of need to know about this method is that this numerical option improves mass and momentum conservation, number one. And it also involves offers enhanced visual insights into the behavior of the flow. So I'll give you two little examples here. One is just a bucket spillway. You can see those little yellow droplets. Those correspond to small areas of fluid that are not resolved by the mesh anymore. So this is not a very fine mesh, but you can see things that are too small to be resolved, well, they become fluid particles. And so, as expected, what we are seeing here are basically the kind of outskirts of the jet, where the jet is very, very thin. Well, that is now has been changed into a fluid particle. Okay, so that's how that works. There's another interesting example. It's an HPDC, high pressure die casting filling. And these types of fills are full of fluid breakup. And so what this model allows us to do is to handle that fluid breakup and preserve the entirety of the fluid, which will in fact eventually reverse to reintegrate the surrounding flow. So what you see on the right there is actually the number of droplets. And not surprisingly, if I replay this from the beginning, at this stage there's a lot of fluid breakup, but over time, as the casting becomes more and more full, these droplets are going to reintegrate the flow, and the number of droplets is going to diminish. You can see that very clearly on the left-hand side. Okay, so this is really interesting model, and how do you activate it? In Flow3D and Flow3D Hydro, it's in the numerics, and it's very simple. It's in the volume of fluid advection, and you will simply check that box, converts to particles if smaller than, and that number on the right there is the percentage of the fluid fraction. So it could be 1%, 5%, 10%, you can decide. And then in Flow3D Cast, this is in the models tab where you can turn that on. Okay, there you go. So finally, some user interface improvements, additional solver features. So there's so many small things that it's not really worthwhile going through all of this. A lot of user interface improvements are kind of don't really need to be explained. This kind of self-explanatory, you know, things just work better, look better, or simpler for the user. So as you open Flow3D or Hydro or Cast, you'll see that things are more modern, simpler, better layout, and so on. And then there's some additional flow solver features, which you'll see that just a lot of small little add-ons, which are best probably found in the what's new section of the user site. So one a couple worth mentioning. Initial conditions widgets, repurposed from the Flow3D Hydro. So what we found is that we redesigned the initial conditions widget in Hydro, and it's really nice. And so we've ported that basically to Flow3D. So we have now tabs for global parameters, fluid regions, and region pointers. Everything now is kind of compact, simple. You can get all the information that you need immediately at your fingertips. So that's one of the improvements that we've done. And then we did the same thing for the output widgets. And that's also a really nice development that we did for Hydro that we decided to bring into Flow3D as well, just because it's been so appreciated and kind of clearly has been an improvement in terms of how we handle spatial or selected data, restart data, spatial data, geometry data, and additional options. So when you open that, your Flow3D, you will see new initial conditions widgets and new output widgets. We also have, you can watch the video on the right here, but we've also improved the interactive creation and editing of primitives. So now you can kind of do things with your mouse, move them around, you can rotate, you can scale, you can move with a click of a mouse. So that's a little bit more friendly than having to type in kind of numbers and so on. So that's also been kind of expanded upon. And then a very neat feature is access to help. So now if you right click on different things, maybe let's say your physics, right click on your physics, and you'll have an option there to view a local tutorial. So this will then open your browser for you and bring you to the physics part of the manual. Or you could basically right click on the air entrainment icon, and this will take you to a tutorial. You can take a look at how that works. So that's neat. You know, you don't have to scroll through the manual anymore. You can just basically directly go to help at your fingertips. So that's very nice. There have been a couple of simplifications and redesigns of some of the physics widgets. So namely the bubbles and phase change model, the air entrainment, and the drift flux model. So we've changed those a little bit, simplified them, removed information that didn't need to be there, particularly removed repeat information and so on. So we have simplified those, made them a little bit more lean and friendly for the user. So keep an eye out for those. And then worth mentioning also a couple new outputs for cast users, local filling time, local filling temperature, and the local maximum velocity. So those are now activated in the models, and then they are made available as either restart data or selected data in the outputs widgets. Okay, so I think we've covered most of what I wanted to cover today with this release. And the take home is basically download the latest release. Go to the user site, Flow3D, users.flow3d.com, request a new license from licenses@flow3d.com. Please explore the new developments that I presented today. We really appreciate your feedback. And if you can write back to us at info@flow3d.com, or you can write to anyone you want to at Flow3D, we'll kind of relay it to developers, but info is a good place. Send us your feedback, explore those developments. There are some very exciting features in the mix, and look out for next release, which is going to be in just early in the summer or late spring of 2022. So this one will be called 2022 R2, release number 2. Okay, I hope this was informative, and I thank you all and see you next time.